to have clear minds. It's been a long day. Work us up. And Lord, we know that so many died so that we might have this book, the Bible.
Amen.
Help us to defend it, Lord, and get others to read it.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Defending the book is the title of the teaching, or answering the question, how do we know the Bible is the Word of God? We must first remember in considering the Bible that it's not one book, but it's a collection of 66 books written over a period of 1,500 years in three languages on three continents with 40 authors from every walk of life. These books cover every important topic dealing with the human condition. Love, hate, death, sin, marriage, heaven, hell, civil laws, much of what we've been discussing today. The 66 books show an amazing unity of thought and purpose. I have a good friend named Dr. Lois Honeycutt. She's a professor at the University of Missouri, teaches medieval and Christian history. And I asked her what she thought the best evidence for the Bible being the Word of God is. And she said, the Gospels themselves are incredibly rich, nuanced, sophisticated pieces of writing. There is really nothing else like them. People didn't write things like that without inspiration. But so much genius for one cause in such a short period of time had to be God. But the student's big argument is the Bible is full of contradictions. Now they'll come out with such an air of intelligence. They're the first person that ever said it. The Bible's full of contradictions. Name one. That usually quiets about 90% of them. Or you could say, yes, it's full of contradictions. It contradicts your way of living. It contradicts your wicked, evil, selfish, lustful lifestyle.
Yes.
Amen.
One day, a year or two ago, I was sitting on the sidelines at Grand Valley State. We were preaching there. The student came up really angry and vexed looking. And he says, why are you out here teaching the Bible? It's not reliable. It's full of contradiction. And he just looked so tormented. And I said, well, have you ever kept a journal? And he said, no. And I said, well, I have. And when I go back and read my journals, I can read something I wrote one day and read something I wrote another day, and it seems like I'm contradicting myself. But you have to know what's in between, or the context in which I'm writing it. Well, this boy, it's like he immediately went, and he said, thank you so much for sharing that. I mean, he almost looked like he had been born again. There was such a change on his countenance. And I was thinking on the inside, you're convinced that easily? Let me tell you here, I've got a whole bunch of more information we can go over. That's just my first argument. But there's a lesson in that, not just a lesson for how to defend the Bible, but often the devil is tormenting people with just one little thing. And that especially somebody that's open to salvation or ripe for salvation. One little thing that wouldn't bother me or wouldn't bother you or what it's something different for everybody that the devil gets. It's like a thorn there in the finger. And if you can pull that out, suddenly they're really open to the gospel. Yes?
I was going to say, another way of that I found out, the Chinese was just explain, all right, if you're an artist and you paint a picture, one artist sits on this side of the room, one artist sits on that side of the room. They're still copying the same bowl with leaves on it, but they're going to see it from different perspectives. So they'll see it from different perspectives, but it's the same thought that they're giving word to. Mm-hmm.
So that was an issue in China too, I guess. Mm-hmm. So I've got five keys here to reconciling supposed contradictions. Number one, omission does not equal contradiction. Just one example here. In Luke 24, verses 1 through 9, it says that two angels were at Jesus' tomb after the resurrection. Matthew 28, 1 through 8, mentions an angel. Is this a contradiction?
Here again, two different views. Mm-hmm. Same story, but all right, maybe it was told by two different people and what they saw.
Yes, because one is by Luke and one is by Matthew. But another key is Matthew doesn't say there was only one angel. He just talks about the angel that spoke and rolled away the stone. But he didn't say, oh, there was just one angel there. It's just recorded that the angel rolled away the stone and this angel spoke.
Okay, what is the verse again?
Matthew 28, 1 through 8. Okay. Oh, I guess I didn't have it on the outline. I can send it to you. And Luke 24, 1 through 9. Luke 24, 1 through 9 says there's two angels. Matthew 28 mentions there's an angel. But basically, the bottom line is Matthew decided to omit the fact that there were two angels. Mm-hmm. He only talked about one angel. I mean, there could have been even more angels there for all we know. Luke spoke of two angels, and Matthew tells about one. But just to confirm what you were saying, I remember when Kirsten and I were at Grand Valley, she calls her mom and starts telling her what a calm day it was. And I'm thinking, the Muslims were all up in my husband's face and in Brother Raquel's face. And she had a calm day? I didn't have, where was the calm day? But then we discussed it, and to her, the day before, she was getting rebuked pretty harshly. So for her, it was a calm day and a much better day. Point number two to reconciling contradictions. Differing accounts, which is closely tied with the omission thing, differing accounts aren't necessarily contradictory. Matthew and Luke, for example, differ in their accounts of Jesus' birth. Luke records Joseph and Mary starting in Nazareth and traveling to Bethlehem, Jesus' birthplace, returning to Nazareth. Matthew starts with Jesus' birth in Bethlehem, relates the family's journey to Egypt to escape Herod's rage, and then recounts their travel back to Nazareth after Herod's death. So they just told to tell different parts of the story, different things that happened. It's important to remember the Gospels never claim to be exhaustive records. Biographers must be selective in what they include. So if you've got five preachers, you're going to have five reports. But the key is we know that God led the writers of the scripture and led them to give their particular report. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad there's four different reports. Mm-hmm. And I think there's such a perfect balance. There's so much alike that the liberals want to discredit the Bible and say they copied each other. Yet then they'll nitpick and try to find contradictions. They do one and then the other. So Number one is omission, number two, differing accounts, number, is there any question about that? I'm kind of going through it fast.
No, I just want to say something though, a lot of us get these from their teachers, they've heard the teacher said that. I know when Michael was in high school, about the kids that were eaten by the bears.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was a big thing, that, you know, told them that, and the kids all believed it and went, got their faith, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay, number three is you've got to get the proper interpretation of the scripture. It needs to be taken in context, you've got to have the definition of the words, and you need to study it carefully. Have you really done that? Number four, you need to know if the scripture is to be taken literally or figuratively. One way will really throw the students, I got this from my husband, is he'll say, don't take me so literally. Or we'll say, you're taking the Bible way too literally. And that really throws them because they consider us, we're the fundamentalists, we're the ones that believe in the literal interpretation of the Bible. But my husband always says, Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. That doesn't mean he's a loaf of bread. He said, I'll give you living water. He's not talking about H2O. So no, we don't take everything in the Bible literally. We believe it's the inspired word of God, but some of it is meant to be taken figuratively. So, and we're going to look at an example here as we go on down. Of a real big contradiction or seeming contradiction and hash that out and we'll see if it does have to do with figurative language. Number five is there can be missing information. Some scripture can appear to be contradictory because we do not understand the culture or the history or the context in which it was written. And I think most of these things we can work out. There are a few things in the, maybe some record keeping and the histories. Frankly, it doesn't bother me if there was some mistake in a number or something. It's not going to make me think it's not the inspired word of God. But I really don't think there is any mistake. I think in the end, when we're all interested, God will explain it. You know, every last thing will work together. But I think there is some missing information. Any question about that, Paul? Okay, you're really thinking over there.
Yeah.
Okay, now this once when I was really witnessing to my father, he said Moses contradicted himself. And the book of John contradicts Moses. Who knows what, does anybody know that contradiction? Has any student brought it up to you? You know what it is? Okay, let's look at Exodus 33. Exodus 33, verse 11.
And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend, and he turned again into the camp, and his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle.
Okay, skip down to verse 20.
And he said, Thou cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live.
Okay, so it says in verse 11, the Lord spoke to Moses face to face. Mm. And then in verse 20, God said to Moses, no man can see my face. Now look at John 1, Gospel of John 1, 17 and 18.
For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him.
You know, I can just remember my father really going over this and being so angry and frustrated. The Bible is contradicting itself. It says in Exodus that Moses saw God, and then here it says no man has seen God. Look at Deuteronomy 34 again.
And there arose not a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face.
Okay. Has anybody got an answer for this?
I think I might.
Okay.
When it says face to face, and he says, as a friend talks face to face, I thought that it was a figurative face to face, the fact that, they were in unity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not a literal face to face.
Yeah, that's a big part of it.
I have a thought. In John it said that no man has seen God's face. Is that what it said? Or no man has seen
God at any time.
Okay, and in Exodus it says, never mind, that doesn't make sense now. I thought it said that no man had seen God's face in John. Is that not what it says?
No, it just says no man has seen God in the King James. Or did it say God's face in
your? I didn't read that, but
something God had lived.
Well, Exodus 33:11 defines what it means to be face to face. And to be face to face is as a man speaks unto his friend.
Yeah.
Exodus 33.
Yeah, that's the first verse we read. So it already defined what face to face is like.
Yeah. That's a big key. That he's speaking to a friend. Okay, look closely. It never says that Moses saw God face to face. It says God spoke to Moses face to face. And that God knew Moses face to face. So it's true, you can't see God's face. And that no man has seen God. In both texts, Exodus 33:11 and Deuteronomy 34:10, God is the subject, not Moses. We're told what God did, not what Moses did. In neither text do we see the word see or anything which is interchangeable with it. In Exodus 33:11, God spake to Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend, which is what Kirsten and Joshua were pointing out. The term or phrase face to face is not used here to refer to their physical position, like face to face, but the intimate nature of the Lord's discourse with Moses. So it is about his relationship. They had this relationship like they were face to face. John Wesley said, he, God, spoke not as a prince to a subject, but as a man to his friend, whom he loves, with whom he can take sweet counsel. Now let's look a little closer at Deuteronomy 34:10. Deuteronomy 34:10 says that the Lord knew Moses face to face. Again, the phrase face to face is not being used as a physical position, but of their relationship. How did the Lord know Moses face to face? Joshua.
As a friend.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
in terms of relationship.
Read a little. The next verse. I thought maybe you had read it.
34:11?
Yeah, 11 and 12.
And all the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his servants, mighty hand, and in all the great terror which Moses shewed in the sight of all Israel.
Mm-hmm. So that it's a comma there. At the end of verse 10, it says, Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, comma, in all the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to do. So the next two verses describe what it meant and which way Moses knew God, the Lord knew Moses face to face. They had this intimate relationship, and a big part of it were these signs and wonders that were done.
Wasn't Moses a friend of God? The one that was a friend of God?
Abraham,
a friend of God. Yeah.
But I think the face to face will mean that friend of God too.
I have a question about the New Testament verse that we read in John. It said that no man has seen the Father, but Moses saw the back of God.
You know, I didn't think of that when I was studying this. But I did just think of it when we were reading it a minute ago.
With that John what?
But so I'm open to different, John 1:18.
What if seeing God is like seeing the whole person of God? Because he only saw part of God. He didn't actually see the whole being of God. Like his face is a big part of
him.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't see his face.
Yeah.
And opposed God is a spirit. Right?
I point out the word new, K-N-E-W. When the word new was used in the King James, it was a sexual knowing. And at the same time, it meant a very intimate knowing. Mm-hmm. And so here, in using the word new, this would be a very intimate situation, not necessarily a physical situation, mm-hmm. but a spiritual situation, as you're saying back there with God being a spirit. And so those that worship God must worship him in spirit and in truth.
But we have spirits, but we have a body. Doesn't God have a body? But he's also a spirit.
It says he is a spirit, but also we're saying Jesus Christ came as
flesh
and blood. And so in that we're saying, all right, we see God within Jesus. And so, yes, he may have a spirit, he may have a body, but at the same time, it's a situation wherein we don't know everything yet. We're still just worshiping a spirit in truth. And someday it says we shall be like him. All right. What is it that we shall be like? In the soul? In the spirit? Is that the part that is like man? And the word image? Is that what is we are to be, the image of God?
I think there's more to the spiritual than it is to the physical too, because I think Jesus is referred to as light, and he's bronze, and it just, Revelation gives a couple different expressions mm-hmm. of what his appearance is supposed to be. And then I was thinking along the lines of that we're supposed to be transformed, and how Adam and Eve, they didn't know that they were naked, so they were uncovered somehow. So I think that they were probably more like God in the spiritual than in the physical. But once they sinned, they became more physical. So that they knew that if they were sinned or they were naked.
I need to think about this 1 John 1:18 a little more, but let's go on. I have some other good stuff. But let me just to sum that up, in the Bible we often see the figure of speech, seek the face of God. Yeah. And it has to do with relationship. In 1 Chronicles 16:11, seek the Lord and his strength, seek his face continually. That's not talking about seeing God in the physical, but having a relationship, knowing him, seeking to obey him wholeheartedly. Psalm 105:4, seek the Lord and his strength, seek his face evermore. Ezekiel 39:29, neither will I hide my face anymore from them, for I have poured out my spirit upon the house of Israel, saith the Lord God. So, without going into this with any more discussion, I'm not sure that this 118 isn't talking about in a spiritual sense or just the knowledge of God, especially since it says that Jesus is the one that declared or revealed God. But I need to think that through. But anyway, I still think we get a good point here on how you look at the scripture, and at the beginning it can seem like a contradiction, and then you look more closely. And you can figure it out by considering literal or figurative, proper interpretation, getting the context. And there's always more work to do with that. Okay, evidence for the truth of the Bible. And I've got here 7. As you can see on your outline.
I have 25 on my list, if you want some more. Oh, I'll email it to you.
Okay, good. I'd like to have that. Number one, this is not an exhaustive study, but this is just kind of what works for me, sharing things with students once you get them to this point and that are really open. And, you know, when you're doing the apologetics thing, it's got to be something that you really can understand. I could never really get much out of the Josh McDowell books, maybe a little, but it really didn't, it was just for me, it's not critical of him, maybe I didn't have the intellectual ability at the time or whatever, it wasn't the right fit, even though they're great apologetics books, you know, I don't deny that. So this is what really helps me. And maybe it's a kickstart for you. But ultimately, you've got to find kind of your own answers and the way you want to answer these questions and arguments. Number one, self-evidence and intuitive knowledge tell us the Bible is true. Intuitive knowledge is exhibiting truth to the mind on bare inspection. In other words, this makes sense. Or rings true to my mind and conscience. Self-evidence or certainty self-evidence is evidence or certainty resulting from a proposition without proof. It means without further proof. Evidence that ideas offer to the mind upon bare statement. Something so obviously true that it doesn't need further proof. One thing that convinced me to really consider that the Bible might be true, I didn't believe it was true, I was skeptical after a couple of years in college, and I was giving my grandmother all the arguments against the Bible. And she was not living a Christian life, but she started arguing for the Bible. And she said, Cindy, it has to be true. And I thought, this woman is 65 years old. She could die anytime. And she's living contrary to the Bible, yet she's convinced it's true. Well, maybe it is true, because she didn't have any ulterior motives for believing that it was true. So that made me really consider it. And then the convincing thing for me was just reading the book of Genesis. Mm-hmm. And I thought no one would make up this stuff. The book of Genesis really describes the human condition. You know, to me, intuitive knowledge told me it was true. There are really no heroes except God, although Joseph is a big hero too. But, you know, all the faults are brought out. It shows selfishness, bitterness, jealousy, sexual immorality. And this book that was written so, so long ago, this book of Genesis, is so true to how man is in 1978 when I read it. So that was the real convincer to me. And then as I got through the whole Bible, I realized that it answers all of life's important questions. And I can remember when I was a college student, before I was a Christian, girls in my hall would come up and say, "Cindy, you really seem to have it all together. I wish I could be more like you." And I knew I didn't have it together. And not only did I not have it together, but I didn't have any answers for them either. But I read this book, the Bible, and it answered all of life's important questions. Who are we? Why are we here? What is the purpose of life? How do we live in a loving relationship with God and our neighbor? How do we have a happy marriage? How do we raise happy children? All of it is answered in this book. So it's not outdated. It's very current. The book with all the answers to all the important questions. Number two, philosophical evidence for the Bible. The Bible intelligently and convincingly answers the four great philosophical questions. Brother Jed has a message on this. Some of you have heard it several times. It's also on his YouTube. But the four great questions, who knows what they are, that any philosophy has to answer.
What is truth?
What's our purpose or destiny, I guess?
What's our destiny? What's our purpose? That's the meaning of life.
Where did it come from?
The what? The origin, and one more. Origin of life, meaning of life.
The destiny.
Destiny, morals. What is the source of morality? So the Bible answers those important questions better than any book or any system of philosophy. It's the most reasonable answer. And you can check out Brother Jed's teaching on YouTube if you haven't. If you want to read the short version, it's on our website too. Number three, the spiritual evidence for the Bible. The Bible addresses man's spiritual problems and removes the guilt of sin and brings peace and joy. Our problem is that we're lost in our sins. Our problem is we live for self-gratification. And all 40 authors, all 66 books clearly tell us that's our problem. We're living selfishly. Man can't be happy living selfishly. We need to be born again. We need to be changed by the power of Christ. And then we'll have peace and holiness. This book demands personal holiness. Not just right actions, but that we've got to have the right motives.
Yeah.
Through faith in Christ. Number four, scientific evidence for the Bible. To me, the greatest evidence for the greatest scientific evidence is just the complexity of the world, especially the life it contains. No statements in the Bible contradict any scientific fact. And you can study either, if you Google science in the Bible, you can find a list of things supposedly that the science statements the Bible made that supposedly were inspired, proved the Bible that was inspired, because there were no way the writer could know those things. But I don't know. I don't know enough. I read those things. I don't know enough about science to know if that's true or not. But it is an interesting study. One student brought up to Sister Pat that the Bible claims that pi is only 3 based on the measurement of a vessel in 1 Kings 7:23. I've had a student bring that up to me once in a while. Don't freak out. They only come up with that once every 10 years. I think in my whole 35 years of preaching, they've asked it once. But it's a simple answer. Either they were rounding the numbers, or it wasn't a perfect circle, one or the other. So there's not really any science contradiction. But if you go to an atheist website, they will have a list of things that supposedly the Bible is unscientific, but I don't think they've got anything to stand on.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. That's where it gets to the point of, like, where I was saying, I realized I wanted to not believe, or I had a prejudice against it. And I've been with that guy for a year. And, like, I mean, it takes some work to get to that math. You know? I mean, at that point, you're like, you know, what's really driving this? You know, it's like a passion for math.
Yeah, true. You had heard this pie one?
No, I've never heard this. I just.
Okay, First Kings, what was it?
7:23.
It's on the paper.
Okay.
You know, sometimes I'll kid them and say, I can come up with one better than that. Is that the best one you have? No. They really, and then they're trying to Google and search for things, but they usually really can't come up with anything. Number 5, the prophetic evidence for the Bible. There's at least 353 messianic prophecies that Jesus Christ fulfilled. Of course, Isaiah 53 is one of the most clear and powerful. I love that book, that chapter in the Bible. You can read so many times. I've read it to a Jewish person and just seen them change colors. Yes.
You mentioned Genesis when we first kicked off the evidence for the truth, and I was told, and now I haven't really gotten into reading any other types of religious books like the Quran and the Jehovah's Witness. They have their own Bible, and they have others out there, but it's the only book that says. In the beginning, anybody ever heard that before? The Bible is the only one that says, in the beginning was God. Mm-hmm.
Hmm. I don't remember that specifically, do you, my dear?
No, but I guess, I don't know, it's the only one I know of.
But yeah, I do know they'll come up with that argument that there's all these other creation stories out there and they're similar. And it's again like Paul says, well, that can either be evidence for or against. The fact that all these other stories are out there just confirms it. Or they can say it contradicts it. It gets down to whether you want to believe it or not. And to me, it makes perfect sense. I believe it. Archaeological evidence for the Bible, number 6. Archaeological discoveries overwhelmingly prove that the Bible is the best and most accurate source of ancient history. Now, my favorite one to use on campus is the Dead Sea Scrolls, because when they found the Dead Sea Scrolls, the skeptics really thought they were going to disprove the Bible. And then they read the book of Isaiah, and the scroll they found is 1,000 years older than the manuscript of the book of Isaiah that we have. And it was exactly the same. There were a few minor differences, like what you would call a jot or a tittle, but nothing that changed the meaning in any way, shape, or form. And so it just proves that they were very careful with the Bible as they copied it. You think it's 1,000 years different. And it's the same.
That's awesome.
Then there's, I've got a whole list of things here that, different things where only the Bible mentions certain kings or certain places. And so skeptics would try to discredit the Bible because nothing else in history mentioned those kings or those places. And then they made these archaeological discoveries, the Bible says. We'll go over a couple of them here. The discovery of the Ebla archive in northern Syria in the 1970s has shown the biblical writings concerning the patriarchs to be viable. Documents written on clay tablets from around 2300 BC demonstrate that the personal and place names in the patriarchal accounts are genuine. The name Canaan was used in Ebla, a name critics once said was not used in that time and was used incorrectly in the early chapters of the Bible. And it goes on with some other examples that discovery proved. I think another important thing to bring out is students will have this idea that the Bible is just a myth or a fairy tale. And the Hindus, they will talk about the Hindu myths. They admit it's myth. They don't have any problem with that. So I like to point out, all through the Bible, we have people, places, names. You can find these places still on the globe. These places still exist. And you have dates. It wasn't once upon a time, but there's dates. They don't date things exactly the way we do, but they dated it according to the kings or the Jewish calendar. Yes?
I'll say another thing is the name of Noah's wife. The minority group that I ministered with toward the end of time there in China, they had the name of Noah's wife in their mythology as being a great long 25-letter, I can't pronounce it, but it started with an M, and it sounded exactly like the name that the ancient Irish had written for the name of Noah's wife. And yet those two groups had never gotten together, but God planted this name in both of them.
So you think maybe it is?
I'd say that was one group that for me was very
You think
graphic.
It was really her name?
I really do, from the fact that
it's interesting.
Both of these groups here are on the opposite sides of the world, and yet they have the same name. They pronounce it in the Miao Sioux, they pronounce it in the Irish. And when you listen closely, it is the same pronunciation. They spell it, you know, Chinese letters, they spell it in Gaelic and ancient Irish, but it's pronounced the same way.
Send me your information on that. Okay, another discovery. The Hittites, who's ever heard of Hittites, were once thought to be a biblical legend until their capital and records were discovered in Turkey. Many thought that biblical references to Solomon's wealth were greatly exaggerated. Recovered records from the past showed that wealth in antiquity was concentrated with the king, and Solomon's prosperity was entirely feasible. It was once claimed there was no Assyrian king named Sargon, as recorded in Isaiah 21, because this name was not known in any other record. Then Sargon's palace was discovered in Iraq. The very event mentioned in Isaiah 20, his capture of Ashdod, was recorded on the palace walls. Mm-hmm. And there's even an archive itself. This is a really interesting. Another king who was endowed was Belshazzar, king of Babylon, named in Daniel 5. The last king of Babylon was Nabonidus, according to recorded history. Tablets were found showing that Belshazzar was Nabonidus' son, who served as co-regent in Babylon. Thus, Belshazzar could offer Daniel the third highest, quote unquote, the third highest ruler in the kingdom, Daniel 5:16, for reading the handwriting on the wall, the highest available position. So here we see the eyewitness nature of the biblical record, as it's so often brought out by the discoveries of archaeology. Yes.
Do you spend time showing the students this type of information?
Yeah, not when I'm preaching.
Okay.
Probably because I don't have it memorized well enough. But I've got it in my iPad, and if I talk to someone, then I'll show them, and, you know, I do show it to them. It's not like an everyday thing that I share with them. How much of the Bible have you read? That's what my husband always asks.
Good question.
As an intellectual, you should read the book that's had the greatest influence on world history. And that's one thing we always try to do, is challenge the students to read the Bible. And usually 90% of them say, yes, I should read the Bible, whether they're going to do it or not. And we have these little black Bibles, not like this, but they're smaller. And they only cost $5. That's just a pack, got one there. We ordered those. You can get them cheap from a missionary society. They're KJV, if you like that translation. And most students still like the KJV. And we will sign the Bibles to them. And one day, I haven't done it lately, but we had this contest going that if they could quote the Ten Commandments, they could get a free Bible signed by all the preachers. And
did we give any away?
We've had one or two winners, I think, so far. But I think it's really important when you've got somebody interested to give them a Bible and sign it, say something special to them. Brother Mikhail was witnessing to this Hindu guy, and he was very interested. He's not really a practicing Hindu, but from a Hindu family. And he was just really interested in the stories in the Bible. And the Gideons had only given him a New Testament. So he was excited when I gave him the Old and New Testament. And I wrote something to him. He told me his name, and whatever his name meant, I just related it to the gospel. Can't remember what it was exactly.
Oh, that's a neat story.
So there's some wild statements that students will make. King James wrote the Bible, and he was a homosexual. They're not doing the homosexual one lately because it's so in to be a homosexual. But back when it was not so in to be a homosexual, it was King James wrote the Bible and he was a homosexual. The Bible condones rape, genocide, and slavery. Brother Jed had a big debate about this at formal debate at Arizona State. And it's on YouTube, and he's also got it just written out, his answer to this question, on our website, so if you want to check that out. The other thing, they will come up and they'll say, at the Council of Nicaea, Constantine decided what books would be in the New Testament and which ones would be thrown out. Who's ever heard that one?
Mm-hmm.
I just love it if they say that, because you can make them look so stupid. Because the Council of Nicaea had nothing to do with deciding what books were going to be in the Bible. Who knows what the Council of Nicaea was about?
I have no idea.
I preached for decades on the campus and didn't have any idea either. It just became an issue with that book. What was the name of it?
Like Da Vinci Code.
Yeah,
that's when
it became an issue.
Yeah.
And it's in that book and movie that it says this all happened at the Council of Nicaea. And it was actually my friend, Dr. Honeycutt, that taught me on this. But if you tell them, they'll say, that's not right, but then they can Google it and see that what you're saying is true. Because even Wikipedia knows that the Council of Nicaea.
So that's the answer, just someone that's not.
No, no. I'll tell you what it was about. Okay. It dealt with issues relating to Christology or how one understands who Jesus is. And mainly it was the Arian controversy. They thought that Jesus, whether Jesus was eternal with God or a created being. And a sect of Christians had come to believe that Jesus was a created being rather than he was eternal with God. And in the Council of Nicaea, they got together and they settled that issue. And that's why it's called the Nicene Creed. Any comment on that up here? Are you?
That covers everything.
Any questions about it?
Created being, yes, and not the eternal.
Mm-hmm. Now, how did we get the New Testament? That's an interesting study. Actually, there's no consensus as to exactly when the New Testament books were written or how the canon was formed. Now, when it gets down to it, tradition tells us that this is the Bible. It's just Christian tradition.
What? I'm sorry, I missed that.
Christian tradition.
What?
Tells us this is the Bible.
Okay, I missed the first part.
No, there was no specific council. This was has been accepted as the Bible. These 66 books throughout the history of Christianity. This is my understanding. I'm open to a different argument. But to me, it's kind of interesting that we're Protestants and we're critical of the Catholics and all their traditions. But really, when you get down to it, it's the Catholic tradition that tells us this is the Bible.
Amen.
So we Protestants do believe in at least one tradition.
So you can't say that it's the Bible that tells us the Bible, like First John, where it says.
Well, yeah, the Bible tells us it's the Bible too.
The Word was God, and God.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we can say that too. That the Bible tells us it's the Bible, and they will say that's circular reasoning.
Okay.
But I don't agree with. I mean, I think that's a legitimate argument because there is no other book that says, this saith the Lord over and over, like these 66 books. You know, this volume of 66 books. So I'm not saying it's circular reasoning, but that is an argument they will make. But I find, you know, I really don't need to carry a Bible out there because I've got my iPad and I've got all the different translations. But the reason is I like to make a show of this so they know I'm about the Bible. But more important, I do find that when you open something and just read it to them, once you've got their attention, they will really look.
Did you order your book like that?
Yeah, it's only like $24 from preachinggear.com. But they will really pay attention when you read the Bible. And I think it's important to have a Bible and to read it when you're out there. Read it to them so they can say, oh, that's really in there. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll read the list. Let me read you a list here of the people that are going to the lake of fire. And read it to them. Four? You see it right here? It says four. Yeah, it says hard. So reading the Bible is very important. Actually, there's no consensus as to exactly when the New Testament books were written or how the canon was formed. In 367 A.D., Athanasius, the bishop of Alexandria, made a list of New Testament books. He listed the books that had been endorsed by the early Christians from the beginning. It's not like this guy is like, I'm going to decide this is the Bible. Oh, yeah. That's great. But he just made a list of the ones that were already accepted. Isn't this just amazing? Sister Pat took this, the best picture ever. But you can see these guys are not believers.
Yeah.
They're so captivated.
They look like, definitely skeptics.
Yeah, but we've got their attention.
That's not a posed picture, by the way. I've got 50 feet away from there.
The Council of Carthage confirmed Antoninus's list. Now this is important to remember. What they were saying, these are the books that we know without a doubt are inspired by God. It didn't mean there weren't other books written that were inspired by God. I mean, we know some weren't like the Gnostic Gospels, that they weren't Christian. But, I mean, Brother Jed's books can be inspired by God. There's different levels of inspiration. He admitted he doesn't think he has perfect doctrine. But these are the ones that we know are perfect. The ones that we're sure that Christians have always accepted. These are the word of God. These are the words of the Lord. So, you know, one way you can turn it on them when they say, what about the books that were thrown out? Say, well, you can read those too. If you want to read them, go ahead. But, of course, then the other answer is they contradict things that were in the books that were accepted. So you can't accept a book that has contradictions, that contradicts the other books. This is just the quote I really liked. It is kind of interesting that I didn't really study about how we got the Bible until this whole thing, the Da Vinci Code came out, and the whole Nicene Creed and all. And this was a quote I read from Christian History Magazine. History is a messy business, but it is the lathe God used to forge his people. And the books of the New Testament. One reason the Bible is such a powerful word is that it emerged from white-hot situations, pure and glowing, because it was shaped by spiritual and temporal reality. Proverbs 22:12 says, the eyes of the Lord keep watch over knowledge, but he frustrates the words of the unfaithful. So in the end, we have to decide if we believe that God kept watch over this or not. You know, the Muslims will say that the Bible has been corrupted. And you say, well, what about the Quran? Is it corrupted? No. Why wasn't it corrupted? Well, God kept it. Well, if God can keep the Quran, why couldn't he keep the Bible?
I like the argument where it was written by 40 people versus one person.
So yes.
I'd be corrupted.
I'm just so glad we have the Bible. The older I get, the longer I live and walk with the Lord. And it's a pretty amazing thing for about 1,000 years of Christian history that was the Bible. Thank being a Christian without a Bible. And for a period of 30 years, in the middle of the 16th century, when Luther and Calvin were doing their reforming work on the continent, this was a critical time in the history of the English Bible. Then came the heroes who died for the people, that they might read the Bible and conduct their worship of God in their own language. Today, with a free Bible in all languages and in all hands, we do well to recall that this privilege was dearly bought. 400 years ago, the Bible was in the possession of priests written in an ancient language, Latin or Greek, Hebrew, which only the learned could read. The church considered it inadvisable for the people to know the Bible, except it was taught them by the priest. Many men died as martyrs in England because they had undertaken to translate, distribute, and establish in use the English Bible. The foremost of these was...
Tyndale?
Yes, William Tyndale. Mm-hmm. Bible scholar and translator, reformer, and witness unto death for English Protestantism.
He was a smart man that he would translate that.
Yes. Well, he was educated at Oxford and Brown, Cambridge.
Back in the days, they educated him.
He was really anti-Pope, too.
All right.
This is, so, we need to read this book every day. No doubt it's inspired by God. It's His Word. It's a living Word. It's the Holy Spirit that makes it real and alive to us. Questions or comments?
I'd like to make a few comments. So.
Want to stand up.
The title here is Defending the Book. Really, the main thing, though, is preaching the book. Same with the apologetic sermon I gave today, defending the faith. The main thing is declaring what our faith is. Mm-hmm. See, most people don't know what the Bible teaches, mm-hmm. let alone whether it's true or not. Mm-hmm. And so I said, let's first of all find out what the Bible teaches mm-hmm. on various subjects. Then put it to the test of reason. Put it to the test of what you intuitively know. Put it to the test of life experiences. Test it out in the light of other books. How well other books that claim to be authoritative answer the basic questions of life. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really what is important. We can, same way with the evolution question versus creation. We tend to spend not a lot of time on that. I just want to tell them, what the Bible says about creation. And that's what Sister Pat does. Just one day she got a group of students down, just read the first chapter, eight chapters of Genesis to them. I think that was much more productive than, going into all these arguments that you have to sort of master between evolution and creation. Now, these are not absolutes. Our longtime friend and fellow preacher, Bro Cole, he specializes in this. And he's got the evolution and creation issues all down together. But I notice really, when Bro goes into all these details, the only ones he really gets are the the science students, and you soon lose interest in the general populace because a lot of the terminology that science uses and so on, most of these students are unfamiliar with, and you lose them.
Yeah, but if you just memorize a couple of science terms, most of them are quickly intimidated and want to change the topic.
Yeah, that's true too. And then you get into the apologetics. Well, that really appeals to the atheists and the philosophy students on campus. But then I'll say, but you're going to lose all the girls. Well, of course, I just sort of say that. Fine.